three speakers right now that that we're going to be hearing from before we get to that 11 o'clock timetable. The first is going to be Gregory Jaczko. And I think he's a very, very courageous man, and let me tell you why. He's sitting right next to the Prime Minister. That's not why he's courageous. He's courageous because of what he did, and let me tell you part of what he did. He was first sworn as Commissioner of the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission on January 21st of 2005. Then on May 13th of 2009, President Obama designated him as the organization's chairman. So when you're chair of the NRC, that's a very important position. And in that position, he was serving during the Fukushima crisis, and he recommended that American citizens in Japan, 50 miles outside of Fukushima, be evacuated. And that was his recommendation when this was occurring. Then on February 9th of 2012, there was a vote that came before the NRC, and he became the lone dissenting vote. And that vote was a vote where they were going to look at licensing a new power plant, which has not been licensed in this country in over 30 years. And on that date, the NRC voted 4-1, with Gregory Jaczko being the only dissenting vote, to allow the Atlanta-based Southern Company to build and operate two new nuclear power reactors at a site right outside of the city there in Georgia. And part of what he cited was that, that he could not support issuing this license as if Fukushima had never happened. In other words, let's go ahead and issue the license and learn no lessons from what occurred. And so, yes, we should applaud. So it is difficult to be a dissenting vote, but it is important to do what one believes to be right. And in this case, in essence, it cost him his seat on the NRC in the sense that it caused so much friction with the other commissioners that he chose to move to a different capacity. And since he has been appointed as a post of the congressional panel overseeing the National Nuclear Security Administration. So please join me in welcoming Gregory Jaczko.
Well, thank you, Mayor Polito, for that introduction. I feel like that's better than what I was going to say, so I might not say anything. It's a tremendous honor for me to be here in Southern California. And I want to thank a few people before I begin. First of all, I want to thank Prime Minister Khan, not only for his leadership during the Fukushima accident, but really for his leadership afterwards. And I also want to thank Mayor Polito and Supervisor Roberts for helping to organize this and inviting us here. In all the times that I visited Japan and with all the efforts related to the accident, this is the first time that I've sat next to Prime Minister Khan, and so it's a wonderful opportunity to be able to do that, and I want to thank everyone who made that possible. And I do want to also thank Torgan Johnson, who called me up one day and said, I would love for you to be able to get together with Prime Minister Khan. And I said, sure. I wasn't sure that was ever going to happen, but it did. And I want to thank him for doing that. And I think it's a wonderful thing that he was able to do. I also want to thank Friends of the Earth and Physicians for Social Responsibility who helped to organize. I know putting an event like this together takes a tremendous amount of work, so I thank everybody who was involved. The accident in Fukushima was certainly nothing that I ever anticipated happening. I woke up the morning of March 11th with a call from the Operations Center at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission telling me that there had been an earthquake in Japan. The earthquake was a very large earthquake, and there was the potential, as I was told at that time, that there could be a large tsunami associated with that earthquake. Months after the accident, I was asked when I was first told about the accident and where I was and what I was doing, and I couldn't really remember because it wasn't that eventful what I was told at that very first phone call. The NRC at the beginning was most worried about plants here on the West Coast, Diablo Canyon and San Onofre, because of the possibility of a tsunami. We were focused initially on making sure that the tsunami, when it hit the West Coast, didn't create any problems for plants in the United States. The accident, in fact, didn't create a large tsunami wave. It was well within the levels that could be expected, but it did certainly have significant ramifications for how we look at nuclear power in this country. So I want to spend a little bit of time talking about my thoughts about how I think we should look at nuclear power after this accident. And of course, it's always easier looking back to be right and to be better, but that doesn't prevent you from doing things and from needing to take action. The first important lesson that I think we need to remember and think about is that accidents do happen. That's a very cliche phrase, but it's something that we need to remember and we need to keep in mind. As I was learning about the accident in Fukushima, I often would ask the staff of the NRC why we weren't thinking of that, or why we hadn't prepared for that, or why we weren't ready to deal with something like that. And sometimes the answer was we had thought about it, but we didn't think it was going to happen, or we thought it was so unlikely that it would happen that we couldn't require people to take action and to do something to address it. I think that's a very, very important lesson, and that the accidents do happen. And so it led me to begin to think a little bit more about nuclear power and how we deal with safety of nuclear power plants. And my thinking evolved significantly after the accident and during the accident. And I thought it was very important that we begin to look at not just the likelihood of something happening, but to focus more extensively on what can happen and what goes wrong. In most of the requirements for nuclear power plants in this country, they are required to deal with accidents and to deal with certain accident scenarios. But not all plants are required to deal with some of the most severe accident scenarios. And that creates a bit of a challenge because when you get a very severe kind of situation like a large earthquake followed by a very large tsunami, you wind up putting the plant in a configuration it was not designed to deal with. And as Prime Minister Khan said, in general, nuclear power plants can be shut down, but they don't easily turn off. There are natural radioactive decay processes that need to happen that take time, and they take additional cooling methods to address. The accidents that are looked at for nuclear power plants don't always consider all of those scenarios in which you have a very damaged process, you have a very damaged cooling system. In that case, the plants are not designed naturally to be able to cool and lead to the kinds of severe accidents that we saw at Fukushima. Where I think we have such important lessons to learn is that we have known that for a long time. People familiar with nuclear power and the technical experts understand that when you lose electric power for a long period of time, it's something we call a station blackout event, that will almost always lead you to a large release of radiation. But what was missing was the appreciation that that could in fact happen. And for many people, what happened at Fukushima was a wake-up call. That this scenario, which had been looked at and postulated, but always believed to be of such low probability that it did not need to be addressed, could in fact happen. So the other big issue that I think we need to look at and think about is the role of probability in looking at accidents, and how we think about that, and how we think about that in terms of risk. It's very difficult to try and figure out in a finite world with finite resources where you can best put your resources to make things better. Nuclear power plants are no different. So a lot of methodologies were developed over the years under the name of risk analysis to try and figure out how do we best allocate resources? Where should we put finite dollars in a way that maximizes our ability to do good things, to enhance safety, to make things better? And over the years, that risk analysis was largely developed to deal with nuclear power plant accidents, to try and give a perspective for accidents relative to other kinds of hazards. But I think over time, what has happened is that because those exercises were so theoretical in nature, it was very difficult for them to be applicable in practical decision making. So over the years, we began to rely more and more on the fact that things were not likely to happen, and as a result, we didn't need to spend money to address them. Clearly, the accident at Fukushima told us otherwise. And if there's nothing more significant to think about, it's the cost of the accident itself. A recent assessment that was done by the American Nuclear Society, which is a very credible organization made up of nuclear professionals, estimated in a report that they did following the accident that the overall cost, including economic costs, loss of activity, the loss of viable use of land, is approximately $500 billion. The $500 billion is a tremendous sum, and that is only a minimum, and it depends largely on how long nuclear power stays offline in Japan. Likely that cost estimate would go up the longer they stay in the current configuration. So when we're dealing with nuclear power plants, what we're dealing with is a situation in which you have very unlikely events that can have very, very significant consequences. And what I've come to realize is that the usual ways of analyzing this with risk analysis is not very useful. Because most of the time, things don't happen and things don't go wrong. But when the one thing does that nobody can predict, because it surprises everyone, the consequences are tremendous. So as the accident developed and as we began to learn more and more, one of the lessons that I understood and began to believe more than anything was that we had to pay much, much greater attention to the consequences of an accident, to the economic impact, and to the personal hardship that can be placed on people. Unfortunately, that is very difficult to put into numbers. It's very difficult to design regulations around that. So there has been a lot of resistance to thinking more about doing those things. And when I was at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, there was resistance to looking more significantly at these kinds of things. And I think that's a mistake, and I think it's unfortunate that we have not done more to consider those aspects of nuclear accidents. And I would like to tell you a very personal story, if I could, about I think how these accidents play out and what it means for people in Japan and throughout the world. I was in the role as chairman, tasked with helping the U.S. government deal with a response to the accident in Japan, tasked with helping lead the NRC in dealing with the aftermath in the United States, and tasked with helping lead a group of people who went to Japan to help provide assistance and recommendations to the Japanese government. After I left my job as chairman of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, I was invited to go to Japan. And I went to visit with some people who had been evacuated from the site around Fukushima. And I think it was a very significant experience for me, because it is very easy in the position of chairman to look at numbers, to look at all of these issues in a very objective and simple manner. But when I was in Japan, I met with a family who had been evacuated from the Fukushima site. And it was a grandmother and a grandfather. And they showed me a picture on the wall of their children and grandchildren. And I recently had a son, not before I went on this trip, but after the trip. And the importance of family is something that's very, very significant for people. And this person told me that before he evacuated, he lived in the same town as his children and his grandchildren. After the accident, they all moved to different places. He was living with his wife in a temporary housing area, but his children and grandchildren had to move to another area for jobs, for work, to continue on with their life. These are not often the stories that we hear about this accident. But these are, in the end, the people who are most affected by the accident. So as we think about nuclear power plants, what we need to think about is ways that we can prevent that situation from happening. And not prevent it in a probability way, but prevent it in an absolute way. Now, I think that there are ways to do that. I think that there are ways to design nuclear power plants to be able to meet that criteria. I think that would be difficult, it would be costly, and it would be expensive. But if nuclear is going to be an energy source that is used, I think we have to finally make the rules such that there will never be another evacuation from a nuclear power plant accident. Not a low likelihood of no evacuation, but no evacuation. And in many ways, the rules around nuclear power plants say that, but not in all cases. In some cases, the plants are designed to make sure that you don't have accidents that can lead to evacuations. But in other cases, that does not exist. So as we look at the lessons, that is, I think, one of the most significant lessons, is the importance of considering the economic consequences and the economic impact of an accident. Now, I will say that as we look at the current fleet of nuclear reactors in this country, I think it's very important that we appreciate in the United States that many of the plants that we have are aging. That these plants, and many of them were designed over 60 years ago, 50 to 60 years ago. The technology is very old and it's very outdated. And I think it's time that we begin to reconsider prolonging the lifetime of many of these reactors.